the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart become acceptable in thy sight. Decrease me so that you may increase. In Jesus' name, let the redeemed Lord say, Amen. A couple of weeks ago, I started this sermon series coming from the book of Nehemiah chapter 4. And I entitled that as I'm Not Coming Down. And this morning it has the same title but part 2. It says, I'm not coming down. Look at somebody in the eye and say, I'm not coming down. As we said last week, that the book of Nehemiah and the prophet of that name is one of a book that is filled and packed with prophetic power and sacred passion. We also gave some historical backdrop on what was going on here to place some foundation for you. We said that Nehemiah was seeing the plight of his people, has seen the plight of his people, and is the cupbearer to the king. Because he has seen the heartbreak, the anguish, the calamity, the misfortune of his people, he has a firm and undeniable and steadfast desire to go back and to help his people rebuild the city and rebuild the wall in the holy city of Jerusalem. Help me, somebody.
Yeah.
And ultimately, to bring them back to prominence and prestige and to restore their pride, their dignity, and their self-worth. He says that Nehemiah has had great achievement in his life, for even though he was an Israelite, the Persian king has seen and observed his anointing, and the king has allowed him to be the cupbearer in his emperor court. And so, at this time, the king has allowed the Jews to return to their land after exile and to rebuild Jerusalem. And Nehemiah, at the point where the people have gone back in a meager attempt to rebuild their community. But Nehemiah goes to the king and asks permission to return to his home community to help them to rebuild the wall. Look at somebody say, to rebuild the wall. Interestingly, take note that Nehemiah was deeply disturbed about the plight and the quandary of his people. You see, the wall was a sign, as I said last week or the week before, as a symbol of divine favor and strength of God. And so, without a wall around the city, it says that the city was said to be without favor and thus without perfection. Because it is a terrible thing when you become successful in the king's court, but Nehemiah never forgot his upbringing. It's a terrible thing that when you get a degree in the king's college, but then act like you don't have responsibility to come back to your community to help to rebuild it. If we would just take responsibility to come back to our community, help me somebody, and build the walls, then little girls and little boys would not be shot and crack wouldn't be on our streets. Can I preach this thing? But we are too busy leaving the restoration of the community in the hand of the kings and the king men. And I ain't trying to say anything bad about the king. But what I am trying to say is that until you take responsibility for what God has called you to do, and what God had called you to do and put a calling on your life, that's when you have to understand that you got a calling and you have a responsibility to your calling. Come on, somebody, help me. Now, where the text takes up here this morning is to help us understand, as we said last week, that the devil is not going to sit back and just let you walk into your destiny.
Uh-huh.
One of the things that I have yet to understand, as I said 2 weeks ago, is why Christians get so upset and surprised when the devil tries to disrupt your life. I never understood why why we get so upset, surprised, and disturbed and in awe when the devil starts raising hell. That is his job. Look at somebody and say, that's his job. His job is to get on your nerves. His job is to make you think the other way. His job is just to make you go against God and go down the road with him. Do I have a witness right now? His job is to disrupt your life, to mess up your life, so that you stop being focused on God. Look at somebody and say, that's his job. I don't expect anything less from him because that's what he is supposed to do. As a matter of fact, I'm glad that he does it. Because he only, help me somebody, raises hell when I'm walking the right way. Anybody on my street right now? If the devil never raises any sand or any hell in my life, then I need to start looking back around and trying to figure out what's wrong in my life. And in the text before us, the people are rebuilding the wall. And Reverend Thompson, as they are in their purpose, up comes a man named Sanballat. Now, Reverend Thompson, Sanballat was a governor of Samaria.
Yes.
The Samaritans hated Jews from a long time ago.
Yes.
Because the Jews treated the Samaritans like half-breeds. They didn't even like each other. They wouldn't even go to the same towns. Do you remember in John when Jesus goes through Samaria? And Jesus said, I must needs go through Samaria. The reason why that was so significant was because Jews hated Samaritans so much that even if going through Samaria was a shortcut to going where you are going, you take the long way around. Somebody said that they hate each other. And Reverend, here comes the governor of Samaria. He sees what's going on, that they're trying to rebuild the wall. He sees their purpose going forward, and he is determined to make sure that the purpose does not come to pass. Don't you realize sitting in this pew this morning that there's sometimes a people sitting to your right and to your left who does not want things to go the way that the church wants them to go? Don't you realize that the devil plants, he has implants inside the church? Do I have a witness now? And I don't know about you, but you can't trust everybody, not even in the church. Can I preach this thing? Not everybody who said, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that does what? The will of my Father. I don't know about you, but I want a church where everybody loves one another. A church where everybody comes to church to lift up each other, to pray for each other, to thank each other. Sample that represents, in a symbolic way,
yes,
every antagonistic force,
yes,
that comes against you when you're on the move. Now, keep in mind that the devil only messes with you when you're on the move. Do I have a witness now? And you're on the move towards serving God. How many of you in your life that when you were on the move and you were just sitting pretty, that the devil came up and tripped you up?
Yes.
Come on, am I the only one in the church where the devil came down on me when I thought everything was going right? Help me, Brother George. And everything was going well. But then all of a sudden, out of the corner of my eye, I was blindsided by the devil. But I just stopped by just to tell you, I'm so glad for where my help coming from. Even though when I'm down and out, I'm so glad that my help coming from the Lord. Look at somebody and say, I know where my help coming from. Sanballat represents symbolically the spirit of antagonism that messes with you when you are trying to walk in the purpose of God. Sanballat is the person who is positioned in your life to speak negativity against the destiny God has put in your life. You've got to realize that, as I said 2 weeks ago, that some people just don't like you for who you are. Can I preach this right? You don't have two nickels to rub together, but yet you still are in
you from a mighty, mighty long weight. Your bank account is zero. Your one bank account is overdrawn. But yet you still come to church and acting like you know where your help comes from. Is there anybody on my feet right now who understands what I'm talking about? You better give God some praise because God has brought you through. But don't you know, Brother Chuck, that some people can't handle when your life is on the move. Some people get awfully jealous when your life is on the move. Somebody get awfully jealous. Even though that you got a job paying you $10 an hour, you still giving God praise for that $10 an hour job. I don't know about you right now, but I thank God for where he brought me through from $1.50 an hour to where I am now. That's only God can do that. Anybody ever worked for $1.50 an hour in the hole? Now, where in this scripture do I find where Sanballat, why he hates Nehemiah? There is nowhere in the scripture, Reverend Thompson, where there's a reason why Sanballat and Tobiah don't like Nehemiah. But what I found out is that some people are jealous of what you have. Now, it may not be that house or that car, but they're worried about, they're jealous about your spirituality and how you walk through this life. Come on, anybody feel me now? When you walk into the church, even though that you have a bad week or a challenging week, you still have a smile on your face because you know that God's going to bring you through another week. I don't know about you, but I thank God this morning that when I was down, when you were down, that if you kept looking up to where your help came from, you know eventually it may not be tomorrow, but that God was going to bring you through. Now, let me tell you something else before I get to preaching. Stop trying to figure out why others don't like you or hate you and lie on you and try to disgrace your character. Quit trying to help me somebody to figure out while others plan your demise and scheme against you. Because, Mr. Davis, they are jealous over the anointing and the call. Help me, come on, somebody make it happen now. That you have on your life. You walk around like you got $1 million even though you only got 10 cents. Do I have a witness now? Somebody know what I'm talking about right now. You better give God a hand wave if you know what I'm talking about. Because you know from where your help coming from. And your help is not on built on things here. But your hope is built on things eternal. You said hold on to God's unchanging hand. Is there somebody in the house today who know what I'm talking about? Some people don't like you because your anointing uncovers, now y'all better take this down, and exposes their mediocrity. Some people don't like you because your purpose and your assignment is manifesting a spirit of excellence. Yes, come on. Hey. And because they are living a mediocre life outside their purpose, they get mad at you because you've got a spirit of excellence. Oh, I said something. When you walk in the room, come on somebody, it reminds them that they are not doing anything with their life at all. I'm telling you now, when you walk in a room, they want you to be like them in mediocrity. But you refuse to be like them. When you should, oh my God, they want you to be satisfied in marginality. But you refuse to settle for that. I don't know about you, but they can be mad at me if they want. But if I walk in the excellence of my God, when I walk in the excellence of my God, it means that I can do anything in the sight of God. I may not be like I used to be, but I just stopped by to tell somebody that I'm better than I used to be. I may not have what I had before, but my eyes have looked upon the hills from which cometh my help, because I know that my help. Anybody know where your help comes from? I walk into the house, chest stuck out, shoes shining, shirt buttoned, 10 cents in my pocket, but still know that God is able. Do I have a witness now? Hey, anybody know where I'm coming from right now? You want to give God a frantic wave, because you know where I'm coming from right now. Somebody has been there. But then, Reverend, it hit me. Why? Sambalat was so mad. If you know history, Sambalat and his boys have remained in Palestine during the period of exile. When Judah went into Babylonian and Assyrian captivity, Sambalat and his boys stayed in Judah and took over Judah. Now, I'm telling you a story now. And so, for decades, Sambalat and his boys, Michael, had lived in cultural, political, and spiritual prominence. Wherever they had come into prominence. Yes. The Babylonians had taken over Judah, and the Babylonians had created a political, cultural, and spiritual utopia for Sambalat and his boys. And so, here comes Nehemiah. Nehemiah has come to change the story. Help me somebody. When Nehemiah comes back, Nehemiah becomes a threat in their importance, in their significance. Whatever you decide to make an impact or change, even in the church, there will be those who've been important for so long. There are those who have been important for so long. My daddy's been a steward. My grandmother, before my grandmother's grandmother, had been a steward. Do I have a witness now? I've been a trustee from the turn of the 18th century. Do I have a witness now? But don't you know that when you come and you try to make an impact in the church, there are those who are going to be upset with you. But I just stopped by just to tell you here at Oak Street, don't worry about that they're upset with you. Just step into your calling and let God take care of the situation. Whatever you decide to make an impact, Sister Henry, and change, there'll be those who've been important that will resent you if their importance has been the definition of their worth.
Oh, I said something.
Can I say that again? Whenever you decide to make impact and change, there will be those who've been important that will resent you if their importance had been the definition of their worth. See, because Some people come into the church not for God, but for the position they have been assigned to. Do you want to have a witness now? Some people come inside the church and they put their little badge on and think that they are more worth than anybody in the house. But I don't care what you're saying this morning, but I don't need a badge to be a child of God. Do I have a witness right now? Can somebody give God a pick up a praise? It's not about position, but it's about God. That's why the church doesn't move. Because too many folk are not in for the right reason.
Can I preach?
I know they're not going to buy this one. People who need to be important, to feel important, are people who won't like you when you make an impact. People who need positions to feel valuable will always be threatened by you when your anointing shows up. Do I have a witness now? I tell you, there are some folk that are scared about the anointing, because just let a little get sprinkled on top of them, they're afraid to change, because they want to stay the same way that they've been. But I just stopped by just to tell you right now, it's not about position in the church, but it's about your service to God. When you stand before God, it's all about service, not about student, not about reverend, not about trustee. It is about service. Because you are not to be in a position to feel valuable. You are to be in a position because you are on assignment and because God has blessed you. Don't you know that it is a blessing to get an assignment from God? Do I have a witness now? I don't care if you're a janitor. I don't care if you're a usher. I don't care what you do in the church. It is a blessing to get an assignment from God. Sunday school teacher, it is an assignment to get an assignment from God. And you ought to be in a position where you can declare that even if I lose the position,
can I preach this?
Then I still got my back. You see, when I hang up this rope one day and I sit in the back of somebody's church,
come on somebody,
and I just sit there to be fed the word, that I still have value. Do I have a witness right now? It's not about position, but it's how I interact and have a relationship with God.
Oh my Lord. Yes, sir.
You see, we got too many folk in the church who come because of their assignment. And the value is in their assignment. Do I have in the church who come because you have a relationship and you love God? If you want this role, I'll zip it off. If you can preach better than me, feed me. Do I have a witness now? If you can sing better than me, sing anyhow. Do I have a witness now? Ain't mad at you, because my journey, James, will take me to glory. Do I have a witness now? I'm naked. I came into this world, and naked, I'm going out. I guess there's a part three. Gotta come back next week. But hold on.
I know that's right.
If you don't take anything away from today, know why you're here.
I know that's right.
Know what your calling is. I can't dance like the dancers, but I'm thrilled when they dance. You see, I've got two left feet, and I'm tone deaf, and I miss my clap sometimes, but I ain't mad at it. But I came just to tell you, I don't care what you bring inside the house, I am not coming down. Your prominence, but it's about your service to God. Come on, somebody, help me with this thing. It's about your service to God.
I'm
not coming down. I don't care how many Zambolats are in Oak Street. I'm still gonna love you. I'm still gonna pray for you. And I'm still gonna show you the way. But you gotta understand that I can't make you get saved. All I can do is tell you. I am not coming down. The more I preach, the more the sample that's getting less and less in this house. You don't have a witness here. That's my goal. And I don't care if two people or three people come, I'm going to preach as though it's my last day on earth. You have a witness here. I know some of you are going through something and you know you ask yourself, where is God? Stay the course. God will be there. Come on, somebody. When James, somebody kicks the rug out from beneath him, you hold on to something. Don't come down. Because if you come down, you give the devil what he wants. You want to have a witness now? So you got to grab on to a scripture. You got to grab on to a song. And you just got to hold on to it sometimes and cry your way through the night. You want to have a witness now? Because somebody in the house today will grab on to your song and you grab on to your scripture and you just cry it like that. God didn't bring you through. You will have some witnesses in the house who can give God praise because you held on. Somebody may have the gift of healing. And we get so jealous somebody else has something. But don't you know, James? As long as somebody else can set the atmosphere, I'm going to jump on into it. Do I have a witness now? If somebody else can preach me silly, then they're going to preach me silly. Do I have a witness now? Because by and by, when the morning comes, all the saints of God be gathered home. I don't know about you, but I'm going to tell my story of how I've overcome one. And only then will I ever understand it better by and by. How many people about standing can tell me that you will not come down? Do I have some not come down people? I am not coming down now. No matter what it's all about, I am not coming down. They can talk about me, but I'm not coming down. I can lose my house, but I'm not coming down. Because God will take care of me. How many of you got stories? How many of you got stories where God brought you from? Look to your neighbor and say, in spite of it all, I'm not coming down. Let us stay on the church. Let us stay, let us stay, let us stay.
I don't care about tomorrow.